Using forms to collect data is an integral part of working inside of any kind of database. And in this video, I'm going to be breaking down Airtable's forms for anybody who's getting started in the software. If you're still relatively new to Airtable and you want to make sure that you really understand the full functionality of forms, you've come to the right place, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth, and this is Gap Consulting. It's our mission to help you get the most out of your no-code tools, making sure that you can understand all of the amazing functionality that is available to you. Now, before we get started with our breakdown of Airtable forms, I first want to invite you to join me for some free Airtable training. If you're still working on mastering all of those key components of Airtable, this Airtable Crash Course is going to teach that all to you so that you are unlocking the full potential. Grab my crash course at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. Once you sign up, you can have that delivered right to your inbox. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen and break down the form. Now, before we get started with a form, we have to understand that a form has one function and one function only inside of Airtable, and that is to create a record in one table. I'm going to repeat that. I know it sounds deceptively simple. A form in Airtable only does one thing. It creates one record in one table. Now, why am I reiterating that? Because in many cases, you might have multiple tables. Let's imagine that I had a table here of contacts and then another table of accounts. So I was registering, you know, companies as well as the people that filled out information. If you envision a workflow where you're collecting two different data sets, companies and contact information, and you want to take that into one form, don't use an Airtable form. Airtable forms only create one record in one table, full stop. Okay? So once we understand that, then we can better know when to use Airtable forms. Anytime that we have this workflow where we are ready to collect one record of data in one place. So let's imagine that we're going to do just that. In Airtable, we can collect with an Airtable form pretty much any kind of independent data field. Now, what I mean by that is any kind of field where we can write data to it. So this particular field right here is what's called a single line text field. This is just text. So we can write whatever we want here. Let's say name here. We are entering data directly to this field. Therefore, it can appear on an Airtable form. Now, if we had another field, let's say a currency or a number, we can also use that on a field. So we might have a number field type here. Note that this is where I'm looking. This is the type of data that's collected in this field. And so if we were to use this, for example, I could have the number 5.0, and we could enter that number on a form and collect that in the field. Now, what we cannot do is use any kind of computed field or any kind of dependent field. So let's say, for example, you wanted to take this number 5 and multiply it by 2. So you might use a formula for that, right? We could write an easy formula and simply say, look at the number field type and multiply that number field by the number 2. Easy enough. We're gonna get 10 here, right? In the first record, at least. So we cannot collect this data, this field right here, formula, we cannot collect this or represent it in any way on our Airtable form. This is a really important takeaway, and it's true for every single dependent field type. A dependent field in Airtable is any field that derives its value from something else. It's a computational field, it's a lookup field, it's a rollup, it's a field where we're not entering data directly into that field. So any of those field types, we cannot use in Airtable forms. Be sure to know that. And you can also not display that information. So if you want to have people calculate information and show it on the form, let's say, for example, enter your number here and they enter 6, you cannot show them an output of 12 or 2 times the number they enter. It's not possible in an Airtable form. You must go to more advanced form software if you have that use case. But assuming that you are just trying to collect that independent data, stuff where people can select the field, then Airtable forms are the right fit for you. We're gonna do one more field type here. We're gonna roll in with a single select. This is a field type where people can choose something from a list. So let's say we have a single select field here where we have options. A, B, and C. A, B, C. There we go. We'll create this field. And we can then establish, as people are filling this out, because they're entering data directly to the field, this can be used in the form. Now, the next big thing we need to understand is, now that we have our fields built, Airtable Forms have two different options, and you're going to be pitched on the second option when you go to create a form. So if you were here in the database itself, and you wanted to create a form, you would come down to the views over here, and you would say form. And here, they're going to try to pitch you on creating an interface form. Now, interface forms are great in some use cases, sure. But for our example, I don't want to use an interface form. An interface form is slightly more restrictive in that it requires that the people who add information into that form have access to your interface. So this could be a good thing. Let's imagine that you had a workflow where you only want your employees to be entering data into your database. An Airtable interface form is perfect. You're already paying for those users to have interfaces. You give them a form inside of that interface, and you say, this is where you're entering this information. But if you want to collect information publicly, let's say embed this form on your website, for example, using an interface is restrictive because the interface form will only allow editors for that interface to actually enter data in that form. So the one that we're going to use is the older option here. We're not going to use the interface. We're not going to continue with this option. We want to create a form view. This is the same in every way as an interface form, except that it allows us to collect data publicly. So here we're going to say, let's go ahead and create this new view. And we are going to see here in the upper right corner, the ability to upgrade this to new forms. If we do this, it's going to say, keep working on the same form in our new form builder, making it easier to design and share forms with external audiences. So just because we are upgrading to the new forms does not mean that we're plugging it into an interface. So this is something I'm going to select 9 times out of 10. Let's upgrade, because the new form scenario here, the new form view inside of Airtable, it's just prettier, it's sharper, it's updated and cleaner. So here you're going to see that, again, as I mentioned already, the only fields that we see in our form belong to one single table, and they are those independent field types. Remember, we built a formula that does not show up here as an option. Now, if we don't want a field to appear here on our form, that is no problem. We just click here and say remove. That will push it over to the side of our form. We are not going to see it visibly on the form. Now, for us, we only have the 3 fields in our table, so that's fine. I'm going to actually want to bring that back. And now we see that name has been added back. You'll also see when you expand on the fields here that we have the ability to group this data. So we can actually name these groups, we can collapse these groups, see that information a little bit more easily. If we want to rearrange things on the form, we can just click drag them here in the form experience itself. And you'll see that thanks to the new form builder, we can also do 2 different fields in the same row. So here I've brought up the name field, and I can even go down to 3 if I want to include all of these components here. We can also select this group. This entire group here of information is all on one place. We can select that right here. We can add new elements to that group. We can move the field labels to the side or the top. We are restricted to the top only because we've gone with 3 different components here on the same row. But if we had more space on our form and we had spaced this out with fewer pieces on the same row, we could actually move those labels to the side. So rather than seeing single select up here, we can do that. Now, we also have the ability to show a group title here, so we could say this is group 1 or this is group 2. We can rename this. We can show a description within the group as well. We could say submit the data, or we could say, you know, this is a particular kind of form. Whatever you want to do here to kind of make this more appealing. And then we can also do a background color here, and that's going to add this little shade to all of the elements that are in the group. So this just makes our forms more visually appealing and is only available when we upgrade to the newer form builder. Now, as one other thing, we can select these fields themselves, and this is where we can get in there and kind of get more control over how we're collecting data. So for example, we might say, a field is required. We might also, with the new form builder, add a default value. So if you remember, we have three different options in our single select. I can say, I want this to default to A. People can update that and change it if they want. So we have some sort of data limitations that we can impose to different field types. You see over here, because I'm using a number field, I can do a range limit. So I can say, look, this number has to be less than 100. Maybe we don't want to see information that's higher than that. So Airtable has given us some controls that helps us control the amount of data that we're collecting and also the type of data that we're bringing into the form. For example, here with the text field, we can add a character limit. So we could say, look, you can't put more than 50 characters in this little text field. So some control for us as the end users to make sure that our data is that much cleaner. Now, some closing thoughts on forms here is that we can also pre-fill information on our form. In order to do this, first we have to publish the form and understand what the shared form version is. So to publish the form, as you saw in my upper right corner, I just clicked on publish, and then it's going to say, who do you want to share access with? Again, this is because I'm using that upgraded form builder where I can say, look, anyone on the web can submit this form, or maybe just anyone at my organization. But note, this is an enterprise scale requirement. I have to be on a high tier, a high paid plan with Airtable. I can also say anyone at a specific domain. So if you have my email address, like at Gap Consulting, then you can submit this information. And then lastly, we can limit access just to those people who have base access. Of course, this requires that they're signed in. But for us, as we said, we might want to collect all this information from anyone on the web. Note that we can also require a password to kind of get ourselves a little bit more control here. I will not make that selection. If you want to embed this form, let's say on a website inside of an iframe, you can just copy this little piece of code right here. Or alternatively, we can just share the form link. Because when a form is created in Airtable, we automatically get a URL for the form that we can share and people can submit data to that URL, of course, provided that they meet the required permissions that we establish. So we're going to go ahead and copy this link and we're going to paste it in a new tab, and boom, that's it. That's our live form right here. I see this version right here. It's saying edit. Do you want to go back and edit this? Do you want to go back to the data and view it? The nicest thing about Airtable Forms is that no integration is required. That's it. It's that simple. My form is live. I've published it. And remember what I said, the whole point of an Airtable form is when somebody submits it, it's going to create one record in one table. That's exactly what this is going to do. So I might say name. Boom. Here's my name, Gareth. My favorite number is 10. And you'll see this is defaulting to A, but maybe I want to upgrade it to B. We submit that and we go back into Airtable now and we see that, yes, our form was upgraded. That's great. We wanted that. Let's go ahead and click out of here. Let's go and go back to our data. Right? We have to go to our grid view and we see that information was just submitted. Now note that our dependent fields are still going to do their job. They're still going to calculate. They're going to compute whatever is going on, whatever they're programmed to do. We just can't see them in our form. Now for slightly more advanced forms, we can also pre-fill data and hide data in our forms as well. So we can pre-fill information, we can hide it from our viewers so they don't see it, but we're still actually going to collect that data when the form is submitted. This is more advanced use casing for forms, so I'll break that down in a future video. But this has been basic Form 101 in Airtable. I hope you got a lot of value from it, but do drop any questions you have below, and in the meantime, keep on building.